very exciting day. We are going to start learning from the book Sha'ari Kedusha. It's a book by Rabbi Chaim Vital, one of the most powerful books in our library. In many of my lectures, I quoted parts of the book, and I have the honor and the pleasure to read it, learn it, and teach it and share it with you and the viewers. Very powerful book. Let me first say a few words about the author, then a few words about the book. What are we going to do today? Actually, we're not really going to start learning from the book. We're just going to do an introduction to understand where we're going into. And the book was written about 400 years ago, a little bit over 400 years ago, by the dominating student of the Arizal, of Rabbi Yitzchak Luria, who's known as Rabbi Chaim Vital. He is the dominating student of the Ari HaKadosh, who the Ari told Rabbi Chaim Vital that he came to the world only to teach him. So the entire life of the Arizal was devoted to Rabbi Chaim Vital. Rabbi Chaim Vital, for the ones, if you want to know a little bit of history, was born on the first day of Cheshvan, Aleph Cheshvan, and he died in Lamed Nisan. He was born in the year 1542, died in 1620. So this will be now 400 years to his death this year. Not like the Arizal, Ramak, Rabbi Nachman from Breslev and many others. He had, Baruch Hashem, a long life. He lived for 78 years. And he was a son of a very big rabbi, Rav Calabras. And Calabras, who at the time, that's when everybody was fleeing Spain. They mainly went, all of them, from Spain to Italy, so there was a period of time, it was a very big Jewish community in Italy, and then they started coming into Eretz Israel. His last name, by the way, is not Vital, by the way. His name is Calabris, Chaim Calabris, but in Latin, Chaim is Vital. So they converted, not he, but the name was adapted, and he got the name Chaim Vital, I mean, Chaim was his name, Vital. It was like a nickname. But his last name originally was Calabris. Some say Calabris, Calabras. But nevertheless, he was born here in Tzfat. He's like a real Tzfati. And when he was growing up, he learned in the yeshiva of the famous Moshe Alshech. For many years he was learning here. And after that, he moved to a different yeshiva of the Ramak, Rabbi Moshe Cordovero. Which we started learning now from Tomer Dvorah. And for the ones of you who are local, this is around the corner. The Ramak is buried right in front of the Ari. Next to him is the Rabbi Shlomo Elkabetz. The Rabbi Chaim Vital is buried in Syria. Although there are rumors, they're not confirmed 100%, that Rabbi Pinto, with a special secret mission, went to Syria and brought the grave to Israel, and it's buried in Kiryat Malachi. That's the rumors. There's no 100% that it's real. But if it's not, then the Rabbi Chaim Vital is buried in Damascus. Now, at 1569, the Arizal came to Tzfat. He was already 27 years old, and he was already a very dominating rabbi in Tzfat. And the Arizal came specifically to teach him. And that was already an order by Eliyahu Navi. Arizal got a direct order from Eliyahu to go to Tzfat, to find the Rabbi Chaim Vital, and to teach him. And the story says that when Ari came to Tzfat, in the beginning he wasn't so popular, but the Rabbi Chaim Vital was another one. And he wanted to snoop around to see really who's the Arizal. So once he came to him as a by the way and asked him to explain to him some deep concept in the Zohar that supposedly he didn't understand. And the Arizal floored him. And he was like, he didn't understand. What's that? So he started asking some questions. The Arizal started giving him over some Torah. And needless to say, he was shocked. And then there he stopped and says, I can't tell you anything more. So he says, why? He says, you're not worthy and you're not ready to learn from me. And of course, that shocked him and caused him to be very, very upset, of course. And so he started praying hard for that and fasting and really trying to work on himself to convince Dari to teach him. And then he started teaching him. Dari HaKadosh was teaching Rabbi Chaim Vital, and he didn't get one thing. Didn't understand nothing. Like looking at him, this is not like Dari teaching me or you. Rabbi Chaim Vital was already in a very high level. He didn't understand one word. So they went on a little journey to Tveria, went on a little dinghy, on a little boat, onto the Kinneret, and somewhere, which we don't know exactly where, the Rizal said a few holy words, a few holy names, and the well of Miriam came out of the water, Be'er Miriam. The Rizal took a little cup, gave a cup of water to Rabbi Chaim Vital, who said, She'akol ni'a bidvaro, drank the water, and from that point on, for a year and 8 months, the Rizal would just talk and teach, and Rabbi Chaim Vital was swallowing his wisdom and learning from him everything. And really, there's no really books from the Rizal, by the way. Some people think most of the books, most of the teachings of the Ari HaKadosh is books that Rabbi Chaim Vital wrote, which some of them, I mean, the famous one, of course, is Etz Chaim. Etz Chaim, the Tree of Life, which is broken into 8 gates. That's everything in those types of teachings is called gates, by the way. So we are now going to start learning Sha'arei Kedusha, the gates of holiness. In the next couple of days, I don't know exactly when, we're going to start learning the gates of reincarnation, Sha'ar Gilgulim. Again, we have the gates. And this is, again, the teachings of the Ari HaKadosh written by Rabbi Chaim Vital. And then we find in many other teachings the concept of gates. Why a gate? Because a gate is a path where you can go through to another place. Now, in many cases, these tzaddikim, they open the gate for you, but the question, can you cross in? So, nevertheless, this book, Etz Chaim, the Tree of Life, which is broken into 8 gates, took him 21 years to write. This is not some Alice in Wonderland story. This is a 21-year journey to write. And by the way, he just wrote it, but his son, the son of Rabbi Chaim Vital, who's called Rabbi Shlomo Vital, he actually edited it and brought it out. And this is one of the most powerful works of the Rabbi Chaim Vital. And there's another famous book, Pri Etz Chaim. And then there's a lot of other powerful books. There's a lot of the books. The main ones that are known is Otzot Chaim, the treasures of life, Adam Yashar, Mevo HaShearim, Olat Tamid, Kilat Yaakov. He has a lot of big books. Of course, we're going to learn now from Sha'arei Kedusha, which is a completely different type of book from all of his teachings, by the way. But nevertheless, this is a little bit about Rabbi Chaim Vital. Another important story, just so we understand who is Rabbi Chaim Vital and the connection with him, with the Ari HaKadosh. After the Ari HaKadosh died, after the Ramak died, he was left here, and he used to write text, Ktavim. And I told you already in one of the last classes that he used to burn a lot of them. The Ari Zal used to burn a lot of his writings, so nobody will touch it. But even Rabbi Chaim Vital would keep all his notes very very careful, chas v'shalom, so nobody should touch it or find it. And the story says that he actually was buried with them. He didn't want anybody touching them. And later on, the students, they made what's called a she'elat chalom, and they actually opened up the grave and took out a lot of the ktavim. And the story says that one time, Rabbi Chaim Vital was very, very sick, and there was a very rich individual in Tzfat who hired like 100 scribes, and they stole the papers, they stole the ktabim, and were writing it all night, copying. So a lot of the information kind of was also stolen, but nevertheless, he was very particular, he didn't want this information to come out. And 300 years later came the Baal HaSulam, Rabbi Yehuda Ashlag, who says on himself that he is a spark. After he worked on himself for years, I think 6 or 7 years of real hard work to refine himself, then the soul of the Rizal got impregnated in him in order to come and explain everything what the Rizal did not explain. And this is the work of the Rabbi Yehuda Ashlag that is called Talmud Eser HaSfirot, which comes to explain everything of what the Ari didn't finish here, or what people didn't understand. And that's really what's kind of laying out all the information of the Ari. But nevertheless, Rabbi Chaim Vital was a dominating figure in Tzfat, and at some point there was a threat against him by a certain minister, a ruler, a governor that ruled in Israel, whose name was Abu Sifin. Abu Sifin was kind of like the governor of the area. And he knew, he wanted to find out where is the Gihon, a certain little river. Not really a river, but I'll explain in a second what's the Gihon, in case you don't know. But nevertheless, he knew that there's some powerful secrets in the Gihon, and he wanted to know where it is and how to open it. And they told him that there's a big tzaddik, Rabbi Chaim Vital, and he will know. And Rabbi Chaim Vital had a very high level of Ruach HaKodesh, and he knew this Abu Sifin is coming to take him, so he said a few holy names and did a kfitzat derech and teleported himself to Damascus. And the Rizal came to him in the dream and told him, "What do you do? Why you run away?" He says, "No, I don't want this Abu Sifin to put his hands on me." So, anyways, but Rizal told him, "But you know that if you would go there and open the Gihon, that would be the beginning of the redemption. That was an opportunity to bring the Geula." So Rabbi Chaim Vital says, "Okay, no problem. So I'll go back to Yerushalayim." So the Rizal told him, "No, the time has passed. You had the opportunity and you missed it." In my book about Mashiach, I wrote the whole story with all the details. This is actually, the story is brought by the Ben Ish Chai in one of his books. And in the book that I wrote about Mashiach, I have the whole chapter. I explained the whole story inside out. But really what was going on there, the Gihon, the Rizal told the Rabbi Chaim Vital that this Abu Sifin is a reincarnation of Sancheriv. And Sancheriv came to Israel to destroy Israel. And Rabbi Chaim Vital is an incarnation of the King Chizkiyahu. And King Chizkiyahu was the one who covered the Gihon while Sancheriv came to put a siege on Yerushalayim. And they had obviously some type of a tikkun together. The Gihon, the story with the Gihon was that it was a wellspring. And while King Chizkiyahu knew that Sancheriv is coming to put a siege on Yerushalayim and to try to conquer it, then they dug like a tunnel that the water of the Gihon should go all the way to the Brechat HaShiloach, where they used to pull the water from Beit HaMikdash. And and after that, of course, King Chizkiyahu buried it. And the Rizal says, and there are other sources that say that when the Gihon will be open, that's another one of the signs before the redemption is coming. And a few years ago, somehow they started digging there and opening, widening the whole entrance of the Gihon in Yerushalayim. But Rabbi Chaim Vital had some unfinished business with this Abu Sifin, and the Rizal came and told him that Rabbi Chaim Vital is a spark, an incarnation of King Chizkiyahu, just already told, showing you who's the neshama of Rabbi Chaim Vital. And this Abu Sifin was a Gilgul, an incarnation of Sancheriv. And there was an auspicious time to open the Gihon and bring the redemption. The reason why I'm saying to you this is we need to understand who is the Rabbi Chaim Vital. He was able to reach to a very high level of Ruach HaKodesh. So why is that important for us to know? Because this little book is the manual how to reach Ruach HaKodesh, the divine inspiration, in even to reach to high levels of prophecy. So he's giving us a guide How do you reach the Ruach HaKodesh? Now, interestingly, he says here something interesting. I'm going to quote from the book itself, which is pretty amazing, that he says, wait a minute. And he says as follows. There are four parts of this book. I'll explain in a second what are the four parts. But the fourth part that was concealed for many years, like you showed me in your book, you don't have the fourth part. But he says, "Hachelek ha-revi'i," the fourth part, "be'ofanei ha-yichudim atzmam," he teaches how to do yichudim, unities in the world above, "asher al-yadam yusag ruach ha-kodesh," and by that you can achieve ruach ha-kodesh, divine inspiration. "Kasher bachanti," I have tested it, "nisiti," I have experimented it, "venit amtu al-yadi," and I can confirm it works. That's what he says on himself in the book. I have tested and applied these methods, and I can tell you it works. So he says on himself, and we do know that he had a very high level of Ruach HaKodesh. Ruach HaKodesh, this divine inspiration, is there's different levels of Ruach HaKodesh. Ruach HaKodesh means you can see people's past lives, you can read their minds, you can teleport yourself, you can do all sorts of... I don't like using the word magic in the world because this is called a completely different thing. He was able to teleport himself to different places, reaching very high levels of divine inspiration. Then we're going to explain in the book a little bit what it means. And of course, levels of prophecy. So he starts the book by saying that this is a book to work on my midot. That's kind of why I want to learn it. Don't worry, you're not going to start having prophecies. Even if you learn the book very thoroughly, I don't think you're going to be from the ones who can reach the Ruach HaKodesh. You can try, but most likely it's not going to work. We're not learning the book for that. We're learning the book because he says this book is le'avodat ha-midot, is to work on your characteristics and to refine your characteristics. And he says this is a book of Musar. This is a book where I rebuke you in order for you to be able to apply it and better yourself. And this is why we're learning it. And he says the first and second chapter is to bring you to do Tikkun HaMidot, and really that's why we chose to learn the book. And he says, why do you want to refine your character traits? I'll quote from what he says, "Ki hu hashlemut hanitzchi," because when you're doing it, so this completion, this wholeness, will be eternal, and the result will be shenitbeku bekonam, that you become attached to your Creator, and that's really what we want to achieve. We're not looking for prophecy or Ruach HaKodesh. We're looking to refine my character traits to a point that I will reach completion or wholeness. It's called Shlemut. To reach my true potential, spiritually and physically, of course, but mainly spiritually. Why? Because the result is that I become attached to my Master, to my Creator. That's really what we want to. And I explained that in many, many times, that the mitzvot and the Torah are the tools to bring me to that level. But if I have all sorts of character traits that I need to work on, such as anger and jealousy, and I'm judgmental, impatient, lazy, and many other things, then it's stopping for me to coming closer to my Creator. It's stopping for me to become my true potential. So I need to learn how to work on my anger, how to work on me being jealous and being agitated, whatever it is. We're going to go through all the midot. This is one of those powerful books that teach us how to work on my midot. And he explains that once you were able to work on your midot, of course you can elevate yourself to a higher level by preparing yourself to start getting divine inspiration, Ruach HaKodesh. Now, here he's already taking us already to the third and the fourth chapter, which again, in a few minutes I will explain the four chapters. But he says here something that when a person is able to reach very high levels, I'm going to quote from what he's saying, "Yesh mehem asher hayu mashbiim bekochot shemot hakodesh el hamalachim." Some people reach to such high levels that they knew the names of the angels and how to lehashbia, to make the angels swear, and then to make the angels as they say, spill the beans. So some people knew names of certain angels, and they would force the angel to do something. And by that, you were able to do things. But the problem is that many individuals got the information and used it in a negative way. It can be used both to good and to bad. That's why for many years, all this information, it wasn't so accessible. Because some people got their hands on it, evil individual, and says, if I will have my information, I will know how to... The term is להשביע את המלאך, but it's like, I would say that the not 100% translation, but what it means is to force an angel. An angel is a spiritual robot, by the way. Now, if you know how to decode or to hack into the code of the angel, then you are able to force him to do something. Excuse me? To command. Now, some people, they use it in a very evil way, to force angels to do certain things. If you know the angel's name and his code, then you can control the angels. Now, if you are a normal individual, you'll use it for positive things. If you're evil, then you'll use it for negative things. Therefore, this was concealed for many, many years. And originally, it all started when four great sages entered into the orchard. I'm sure you know the famous story. Arba Gdolei Yisrael nechnesu lapardes. And it says, Arba Gdolei Yisrael, the giants of our nation, went into the orchard. I'm sure you know the story. And the four of them, one of them is Ben Azai. Ben Azai, it says, he peeked in and died. An orchard, of course, it's not necessarily an orchard of oranges. Rather, it means all the levels of the Torah, which is an acronym. Orchard in Hebrew is Pardes. It's an acronym of Pshat, Remez, Rash, Drash, Sod. Pshat is the literal level. Drash is a more of a deeper explanation. The Sod is the secret. And no, we missed one. Pshat is the literal. The Remez is the hint. Drash is more deeper explanation. And Samech, the Sod, is the secret. But this all four levels of the Torah, which of course only one will survive there. Ben Azai was the first one. He tzitz v'met. He peeked in, died. The next one was Ben Zoma. He tzitz v'nifga. He looked inside and he got, excuse my language, cuckoo. He lost his mind, as they say. And there was another one, Acher, Elisha ben Abuya. He also died. And he also first became cuckoo. And the only one who survived was Rabbi Akiva, who peeked inside, yichnas b'shalom v'yatsa b'shalom. And Rabbi Akiva reached to the highest of all levels that I told you already in one of my lectures what levels he reached, that he knew everything and everything. He was able to come down. Rabbi Akiva was a great mekubal. He knew almost everything in the structure of the spiritual world and came down and wrote a few books that most people never even heard of them, with all the secrets of the universe. So Rabbi Akiva was a giant. Nevertheless, so since there was too much damage with this whole Pardes thing, then many didn't know all this information. And he says the problem was that many people would ask or will seek very high levels in Kedusha. Why? To reach prophecy. And when you have prophecy, you have power. If you know the future, you know what the lottery tickets are. Like the, what's his name in Back to the Future? Biff. He came back with that book. So, of course, the younger generation will be like, who? Who? The older generation knows what I'm talking about. But listen, prophecy is a powerful tool. But anyways, some people, by default, they refine themselves and they get what's called the Gilui Eliyahu, that Eliyahu, a Navi, reveals himself to them. And then from that they learn, like the Arizal, the Baal Shem Tov, and many others. But the point is, he's just telling this in the introduction, because the book is divided into four parts. And I will explain now the parts, but the third and the fourth, really, which I don't know if we're going to learn them, because it's almost irrelevant. It's very hard to understand, maybe just for the... Maybe, I don't know. I don't think we're going to go through the entire book. I think we're going to go through for what's important to us. Because the fourth part, for sure, has nothing to do with us. You can read it. I mean, we can read it. We're not going to learn anything from that. I think we should focus on what's important. But nevertheless, he's just saying here that in simple words, that if you follow the manual, you can reach to very high level of Ruach HaKodesh and to be able to perform all sorts of things that are supernatural. And later on, of course, reach to a higher level. And very few people were able to. The reason why it's not recommended, because if giants of Israel like Ben Azai peeked inside and died, we are going to be incinerated if we peek inside. So therefore, he also brings, don't think this is something you can handle. Rabbi Akiva was really the only one who was able to go in and go out. And that's why, to many, why do people are afraid of learning Kabbalah and Zohar? Because they say, oh, I heard you can go crazy from that. Yeah, if you go into if you open a door that is not supposed to be open, or you cross into through a gate that you're not supposed to cross, not good things can happen. So therefore, many evil people who try to have their hands on the information, they suffer their own death with their own curiosity. But more important is to follow what's important to us. And I will read very briefly what he explains, at least on the two first part. The first part, the book is divided into four. The first part, he's teaching how to live your life in the path of Chassidut. Chassidut means that you go beyond the letter of the law. Everything that you do is beyond what Hashem requires to you from you. And also the way of Prishut. Prishut, the translation, is abstinence. But Prishut means that you move yourself away from anything that you don't really need. I can eat. It doesn't say anywhere in the Torah I'm not allowed to eat. But I don't throughout the week. Just a cup of water, maybe a piece of bread. I don't need more than that. Why? Because when you segregating yourself and you're removing yourself from the little things and specifically from all sorts of physical pleasures that you don't need, that's how you start climbing in higher levels. You cannot reach to high levels if you're eating cakes all day long and indulging in all sorts of physical pleasures. So this is called Prishut. So some people, when they reach to a certain level in Kedusha, in holiness, and they're already aware, they understand, they have knowledge, but they want much more. The next level is to start separating from the world. And some people, that's what they used to do. They used to completely separate themselves from the world. They're called Prushim. And they would not benefit or take anything from this world. Everything had to be the bare minimum. Why? Because eventually, at some point, you start separating from the world. We are very attached to food, to beautiful clothes, to good scents and odors, comfortable things. I'm not talking right now of pleasures. This pleasures is for, this is a very low level. So he starts teaching in the first level the paths of Chassidut and the paths of Prishut, which eventually will bring you to Ruach HaKodesh. If you're really applying, now don't think this happens within 3 months, it can take you 30 years to live a life of the path of Chassidut, that your entire life is dedicated to the Torah, and a life of Prishut, that you don't take any pleasure, you don't derive anything from this world, eventually you can start going into the path of Ruach HaKodesh. The first part is divided into six gates. And again, it's all called gates. Why? Because the gate is there. He opens up the gate for you. You choose if you can pass to the next part. The second part is more rebuking. And what is the rebuking? He explains in depth the punishment for all the sins and the rewards for all the mitzvot. And specifically for the positive mitzvot and the negative mitzvot. So this is more rebuking. If you do this, this will happen. You don't do this, that will happen. But we need to know that because you want to be aware what happens when you do a certain mitzvah, what rewards you get, what damage you do when you're doing an avera. So he calls it tochechot, rebuking. But rebuke for the sake of you getting better, not for to putting you down and making you feel like a rag. It's to for you to understand the depth and the severity of your behavior in order for you to refine yourself. And in the second part, there are seven gates. The third gate, it's called Hanhagat Hasagat Ruach HaKodesh. How to achieve Ruach HaKodesh, which is divided into eight gates. And the fourth chapter, or the fourth part, is how to do what's called Yichudim. It's called Yichud Elyon. Some of you who pray with the Sfaradi Siddur, you notice that almost before everything that we do, we say, L'shem Yichud Kudsha Brichu Shchinteh, for the sake of the unity of the Master of the Universe in the Shekhinah. This is called Yichud. Yichud is a unity. Now, when you know how to do unities, Yichudim, in the world above, which can only be done with holy names of the Kadosh Baruch Hu, then you're able to, so to say, I'm going to use the wrong word, manipulate, but you're able to do some type of an effect in the world above that can right away has a result in the world below. And therefore, a person is able to reach the prophecy in Ruach HaKodesh. But this is called Yichudim, and don't think you're going to be able to do it. The Rizal was able to do Yichudim, by the way. Some people, they live in some fantasy that they can do that. You can do that, by the way. It's interesting to learn. But nevertheless, he talks about it, and he also says on himself, I have tested it, I have tried it, I can assure you, it works. And I'm pretty sure that he went to a certain level and didn't go too far in, because that's where things become complicated. And as he says, and I will read it again, Asher al yadam yusag Ruach HaKodesh, by these Yichudim, by these spiritual unities, you can reach Ruach HaKodesh, Kasher bachanti, I have tested it, nisiti, I have tried it, venit amtu al yadi, and I can confirm that it works. Now, he says, and I'm just going to now very briefly go through the parts, just so we know what we're up for. So the first part, he's calling it Mivnei HaAdam, the structure of the human, which he goes into depth about the four elements, earth, fire, air, and water. And he calls it the structure of the human, Mivnei HaAdam, both spiritual and physical. And, like I told you, this has six gates. And it comes to break down also the severity of the damage of my inappropriate behavior. That's really what it will start breaking down to. And when a person does sins, he creates a certain blemish, a damage to the soul and to the world above. And by that, he starts explaining how and what and how to fix it, how to do tikkunim for certain things. What does the damage, why a certain sin will cause a damage? And by you understanding that, it makes you more aware why not to do a certain sin. This is not just a commandment or a recommendation. It explains and also goes to a higher level what happens when I do things that are inappropriate or indecent behavior. Not necessarily that I didn't put tefillin on or I mixed meat and dairy. Also when I behave in a certain way. And the first part really is very, very thorough and extremely interesting. The second part, this is really mainly focusing on tikkun amidot. That's the part where we're going to start really working on refining our character traits and explains it in depth. And like I told you, the third part is very interesting. We're going to learn what's applying to us. And what's really applying to us is how we do what is called Chibur Neshama Elyona LaTachtona. How I'm connecting my higher soul to my lower soul. Because 90%, 99% of my real soul, it's called Neshama Elyona, my supreme, my exalted, my high soul, it's in the world above. It doesn't even come down here. But a little piece of the Neshama comes into the body, and that's called Neshama Tachtona, the lower part of the soul. If you're able to connect them both, then you get a lot of inspiration from your higher soul. which can eventually lead to Ruach HaKodesh and prophecy. But it gives you a better intuition, gives you a more clear connection to the world above. When your prayers are much more clear, you learn, everything is more clear. We're going to focus on what's called Chibur Neshama Elyona LaTachtona, connecting my soul from the world above to the world below. And like I told you, the fourth part, I don't know how much we're going to get into it. This is how you reach the Ruach HaKodesh, which is extremely, extremely interesting. But I can tell you already that even if we go through it, a lot of it doesn't make much sense. We're going to learn what's important to us. So with that said, we are going to start a very interesting journey into this powerful book written by one of the most powerful souls in our history, a pillar in the Torah. And by the way, I've been talking constantly how great Rabbi Chaim Vital is in the path of Kabbalah. But before he started learning with the Arizal, he was a giant, a genius in Nigle, in the revealed part of the Torah. All these Kabbalistic giants first had unbelievable knowledge in the revealed part of the Torah. It's not that they just used Kabbalah. Rabbi Chaim Vital was literally a giant in the oral part of the Torah, which later on, because of that level, he was able to go into the next realm of the mystical part of the Torah. So the information is coming directly from the Arizal, chewed and digested by Rabbi Chaim Vital and delivered to us with a taste of Kabbalah, but the aftertaste is how to refine myself. And that's really what we want to achieve. I want to achieve tikkun amidot. I want to refine my characteristics, my emotions, my behavior. The fact that I need to follow Torah mitzvot, that's equal to all of us. We all have to follow the same mitzvot. There's no difference between one and the other. But when it comes to tikkun amidot, that's personal to me. We all put the same tefillin, by the way. You don't have different tefillin than me. And we all have to follow the same Torah, the same way. That's where we have a common denominator. But when it comes to refining myself, it's me. You don't have the same characteristics as me. I'm lazy, you're not. I'm full of anger, you're not. You're jealous, I'm not. Whatever it is, that's personal. And that's really how you get attached to the master of the universe, and that's eternal. That's what brings you to a completion. And that's really what it all boils down to. We came down here as a dirty diamond, and Hashem says, here's tools, refine that diamond, polish it. I want you to come back and give me a beautiful, polished, clean, 5,000 carat diamond. That's really what I came. I came here as a dirty soul, full of bad character traits. Now work on it. Now the fact that I can acknowledge that I have an issue with jealousy or anger, that's okay. You already went 50% to the process, acknowledging you have a problem. But how do you work on it? How do you work on your anger? How do you work on yourself to stop being judgmental or not to be lazy or not to be any of these horrible character traits? And personally, you want to refine yourself because that's how you reach to completion. Then your mitzvot are performed in completion. And eventually for your eternal life, you are attached to your Creator. So this is the book, one of the many, but one of the top ones that will allow us to reach there and to get to that point. So we are going to start a very powerful journey. It's not a big book. Look at it. It's very, very small. So I don't think it's going to take us much. There's going to be a lot of explanations and examples, but the book is going to reach, help us reach to a much, much higher place of our existence. So I invite you to join us on this wonderful journey, which will start right away. Tomorrow, Bezrat Hashem, every day, I think we'll do a short class of maybe half an hour, 40 minutes. We'll see how we can fit each part into the classes. But we're going to try to go through it in one way fast, but also thorough. And Bezrat Hashem, with Hashem's help and mercy, we'll be also be able to understand what we're reading, and more important, to apply what we're reading. So it should be a ratzon, shehi ratzon, should be a will from the Kadosh Baruch Hu that our learning should be successful, that we can apply it. And as the Rabbi Chaim Vital says, I've tested it, I've tried it, and it works. So Bezrat Hashem, in a few months, we can say, not on the third and fourth part, on the first and second, I have learned it, I have tested it, I have applied it, and what do you know? It works. I'm a little bit of a nicer person. I don't get upset 900 times a day. Only 300 times I lost my anger today. But Bezrat Hashem, if we apply our effort in it, we will be successful. And Bemet, I welcome you to join us on this wonderful journey. So to the depth of the minds of the Ari HaKadosh, how to make ourselves a better individual, refine our souls, and to be able to reach to an eternal completion and utter closeness to our Creator.